My name is Toby Ford. If you weren't at the keynote earlier, I work for AT&T. And then for this session, we also have Mats Karlsson from Ericsson, who's going to talk about some specifics with regard to OpenStack and how to make it work for the telcos and for what we're doing with NFV. I'm going to start by doing a brief review of what I talked about earlier with regard to what we're doing at AT&T on NFV. So generally, as I was describing again, I'll try not to say this over and over again, but the worlds of IT and telco are really coming together, and things are changing pretty dramatically for the telcos because the functions that we do in mobility and in the TV space are getting caught up in the web of the ongoing onslaught of Moore's Law, of automation, consolidation, commoditization, of agile programming methods. All of these things are converging to really drive change in a space that had been traditionally really owned by hardware vendors that built bespoke hardware specifically for specific functions, whether it was in mobility or in the TV space. And so now we're going through and reevaluating all of those things and looking at how can we take them and build them and put them onto a public cloud or on a sort of cloud facility, cloud infrastructure run by OpenStack. And in doing so, you know, we find that many of these elements have very similar characteristics to workloads that we've dealt with before, whether it's scale out pets or cattle architectures. There's many aspects of load balancing, of firewalls, of application servers that have corollaries in these types of systems. And so we're working through the process of how do we take those and move them over. So that's really one of the things that the last 8 months, I really had no involvement at all in the mobility or in the TV space and the vendors that work there. And so over the last 8 months, I've been able to work very closely with folks at Ericsson and other of the traditional vendors in this space and really get to know what's happening. I'd come from very much of a hosting and cloud background before that. And so it's been, for me, a lot of education about what are all these systems about and how it works. So I'm going to talk today about with more detail about SDN and what we've been doing with SDN, starting from within the data center and then expanding to what we're doing with it within the WAN, and then talk about NFV and some of the specifics in that regard. And then Mats will finish off and talk about the about how Ericsson is helping to work on OpenStack and evolve it as a cloud enabler for NFV. So generally, SDN has been something that I've worked on for the last 4 years. We were early adopters of a number of different technologies in this space. We were early adopters of Nicira, worked very closely with VMware on this subject. We've been looking at this problem of scaling data center networks beyond their natural limitations for 10 years, right? So spanning tree issues and VLAN limitations, all these things, this is where we came from. Trying to run multi-tenant hosting network, lots of different tenants, having L2 separation, reservation and separation, all the way as much as possible end to end from their app to their headquarters, from their app to their users. And in that process, we recognized right away why SDN was important. If you look at Microsoft's VL2 paper, it's very clear enumeration of the problem of running a data center at hyperscale, and how you need to evolve it to with more virtual methods. Now that work started with overlay protocols like GRE and SDT and these types of things. And over the last few years has evolved into things like VXLAN and other aspects. Obviously all of that has to work on top of vSwitches and hypervisor networking. So this is, as I was saying earlier today, an interesting concept for me. SDN means four or five different elements of functionality. It's not just overlays and what VL2 describes as a way to solve for a data center network, but it also represents being able to talk one VM to another network-wise inside of a host that's not connected to a network or that doesn't need to talk outside to the physical network. It also evolves to other things like, okay, maybe switch can be a separate hardware device and a software. They don't have to be all produced by one vendor. It can actually be split. And also, as we talk through with OpenStack and try to get OpenStack to work, it's all about orchestrating and creating a common API and mediation layer for provisioning networks. Before OpenStack, there was nothing like this. There was no way to, you know, depend on a reliable API set to actually provision networks, L2 or L3 networks at all. So this, all of these things to me represent what has come to be known as SDN. Now, recently I presented this to some of the folks from our WAN, our more WAN-oriented network folks, and they thought, well, this, none of this is what SDN is, something else. So in that regard, I mean, many of these things in this picture represent what I was just describing as my view of SDN. But beyond the data center, there's a whole nother world or another realm of software-defined networks happening in L1 through L3 in the WAN. And that, in a similar way, has similar characteristics to what I described in the data center. The switches and routers are sitting there as opportunity to be run with more commodity hardware, with more independent OSs. Same thing goes for the control mechanisms and the way that we orchestrate those things. So one example that I have from the WAN context is for us how we provision VPNs. VPNs between us and our customers, between us and our partners. It's one of the products that we offer today. We actually enable other clouds to work on our customers' VPNs so that a customer could have a service from our cloud or hosting facility from us, and then hosting or cloud facilities from a third party, or even SaaS offerings from third parties, all on the same VPN, all reserved and separate connectivity end to end. Now, in the past, this took a lot of work to set this type of thing up between all of us. So this is a months-long process. And since over time, we've worked to actually try to orchestrate that end-to-end, as well as produce APIs that allow us to stitch these things together. This is a very simple example of what's possible, but gives you sort of a sense of where we're heading. Is now we're able to make WAN provisioning more real time. You'll see from us beyond this is just beyond VPNs on networks that were already pre-provisioned or already provisioned before. We'll actually start to get into how we make Ethernet to Ethernet connectivity happen between companies and try to make that more of a real-time experience as well. So as SDN happens in this space, it's as much about API exposure as it is about real-time services, as it is about the hardware software disaggregation or data plane control plane disaggregation. So that's SDN, and that's sort of, for me, deals with the layer 1 through 3 aspect of virtualization in the network space. And beyond that is where I think of NFV. And as so this is a slide of that describes the situation today within a telco or even within a cable provider or a number of the larger service providers. Many of the pieces of equipment that make up their network, of our network, even larger firewalls, larger NAT devices, DNS even, these things run on hardware that is very specific to that function. It costs a lot. It takes a very long time for it to evolve. It takes months, if not years, to upgrade these environments. The utilization is always built for the worst case scenario. These kind of dynamics are not really competitive anymore. And as I was saying before, as the IT concepts start to show up and actually scale to this level of requirement, the obvious question is, why not virtualize? So the next page is, really describes the benefits that we have by taking something from the NFV side and virtualizing them, putting them in containers, putting them in bare metal, whatever it takes to better orchestrate it and to more optimally use the hardware. Get higher levels of utilization, and then make it so that it's easier to upgrade. It's more, has more continuous integration, continuous deployment kind of dynamics. And then the ecosystem around it isn't a small number of vendors, it's hundreds of vendors. And it has very much, and OpenStack plays an integral role in making that happen. And as you see, just in the pluggability within Neutron, we have a lot of participation in how that has evolved. Now we would like to see Neutron go to the next level, even do more of layer three and WAN connectivity issues, cover those types of things. And that's where we really need your help. So this last slide I'm going to do before I pass it to Mats is about an effort that we're now in the middle of surveying the market about whether or not this makes sense. So we're proposing creating a new group within the Linux Foundation's collaborative projects arm that's called NFV Open Platform, with an aim to promote trying to drive the same dynamics with NFV functions as is what's happened in OpenStack and in Open Daylight, as well as promote for the underlying aspects in Open Daylight or in KVM or in OpenStack, have a mechanism to kind of aggregate requirements and push them and have a way of funding more resources to work on these things. So this is an effort that we're now asking people for opinions on, see if this will fly or not. So thank you, and then I'll pass it off to Mats.
Okay. So we're actually reusing the slides, myself and Toby here from the keynote slide. Looking at OpenStack, and I think we see it really as the heart of NFV and the glue that keeps the NFV environment together. And we really need something that is multi-vendor. And multi-vendor in terms of that we should be able to run applications from different vendors, we should be able to use different guest OS, we should be able to use different hypervisors, we should be able to connect different type of plugins from different type of hardware vendors, if it's server vendors or networking or storage vendors. We need this multi-vendor ecosystem, cloud ecosystem. And I think this is key for NFV because that is most likely how the environment will look on the NFV side. So if we then take some of the core capabilities that we said, pluggability, I think this is more or less the same thing as talking about multi-vendor. Pluggability is really the flexibility. And I think this is where I believe you OpenStack is. It's very unique by this pluggable architecture. Of course, you don't get a complete product, but you get the tools to actually build the perfect environment for NFV. So the pluggability provides the flexibility that we need. Programmability, we have to deliver on the promises of NFV. NFV is really about speed and simplification of handling NFV resources and NFV applications. So programmability, without programmability, you can't really automate, you can't efficiency, you can't do the speed, so to say. I mean, one is the whole area of provisioning resources and provisioning applications, as well the management of them to kind of be faster in provisioning, be faster in launching new services, and lower the operational cost for the automation that this framework brings you. Innovation and speed, this is really about the community, the kind of no single vendor can outperform the speed that we see in OpenStack. And I think the good thing now, and I think that's also shown by Toby, is that this open source Linux Foundation stuff, that I think there is a good alignment around a lot of telecom operators and a lot of telecom vendors to go the OpenStack track. I think there is a lot of things that we need to do, but I think there is a good alignment that this is the bet on the future. Reliability and security, I think one of the differences that we actually have in NFV is that we have a lot of stateful applications. And stateful applications means that you can't only close down a VM, You have to actually handle the state, you handle migrate states, etc. Because what happens is that most of your telephone calls that you're using, they are depending on a state in some telecom application. And if you just close down that VM, that call will be lost. So we need to be able to handle the stateful applications because there is like 20 years of design. But we also need to move these applications that have historically been deployed on boxes over to a new type of cloud deployment environment where we can kind of get the benefits of faster deployment and more automation. Telco expertise and features, this is really what we bring to the table. I think we have some good understanding now what we think needs to be done and how it can be done. I think it's also a good opportunity to really combine a lot of things happening in other industry that gets contributed to OpenStack. And I think by doing this, I think we can actually leverage OpenStack even further. And I also believe that some of the features and thinking that we have will also benefit other industry that requires high demands on the infrastructure. Distributed and scalable. When you look on an operated network today, there is actually not 2-3 data centers. There is hundreds of data centers. They have all these different type of location central offices, which a lot of operators want to use in a distributed way. They want to move workloads across this huge network of data center and smaller data centers that are more regional. And really giving actually the capability to move workloads and to distribute workloads in a setup where you maybe have hundreds of data centers. I think this is a challenge. And at the same time, more or less, providing the same SLAs on the end services that we have today in the classical box type of development. Scalability. One of the things is, so say, also, how do you scale to millions of subscribers with stateful applications? I think there is a number of issues that needs to be solved, how we can do this in a very good way. We need to be able to optimize in a lot of different aspects. We need to be able to optimize on cost. We need to be able to optimize on energy. We need to be able to optimize on latency, for instance, where to put the workload from a topology perspective. And all of this optimization we need to be able to orchestrate from an OpenStack type of layer, so say, having this orchestration to be able to do this optimization. And I think in a classical data center, you more or less optimize on single parameter, but here you need to be able to optimize across a number of data centers, and you, for instance, need to take into account strict requirements on latency, which is a bit of a challenge, because then we're actually coming back to what Toby said, that then the wide area network, for instance, need to be part of the orchestration engine. So this is, I will now go through some of the areas where we believe that we need to add capabilities. We also believe that a lot of this capability will also be usable for other industries and other verticals. So if you then start with resource allocation and resource isolation, we need to be able to orchestrate VM and network resources based, for instance, on end-to-end network SLAs, based on subscriber policies. We need to have a very much more advanced environment. How do we actually allocate and handle VMs or network connectivities? This, we need actually to have APIs in the Nova, the Neutron side. Resource isolation is another aspect. When you're having all these different network function NVF applications, you actually need to be able to have a complete isolation from a performance perspective. You shouldn't be able to impact the performance from one application to another. That means that you need a resource isolation in terms of compute resources, memory resources, network resources. So to have the complete isolation, you have no impact between the applications. Networking. We said all about it, that we actually need to bring in the wide area network orchestration as part of the whole solution of the orchestration. We also need, for instance, to be able to terminate the wide area network into a dedicated VM within the data center. That means, for instance, that we need probably have support for MPLS tunneling straight into to a VM. So, and this is things that maybe it's, if you're running, like if you only have a data center, you need to connect like two data centers. But here is actually, there's a multiple number of sites that you need to connect, and you need to be able to move workload. And that's why the wide area network needs to be an orchestrator resources exactly as VMs are or storage are. real-time response. We still have a lot of packet-based application, conversational voice type of applications, where you, for instance, need an interrupt-based scheduler in the hypervisor. You need to have latency figures on the virtual switch and the hypervisor together that more or less brings you to, you should have more or less have the same type of figures for real time and throughput that are similar to a native deployment. High availability. If you just take a standard OpenStack reference type of implementation, you will most likely hit the figures of 3 to 4 nines on the availability of the controller and the setup. What we are looking for is really that we need an infrastructure environment that are 5 nines. And that means that we need to have more support for fault monitoring. We need to have the health check. We need to have mitigation functionality that really can mitigate the milliseconds to move workloads from one place to another, or to kind of increase the network resources. So these are things that, so say, we need to add to the framework. Then if you go more, so to say, to I would say functions that are generally more needed, I mean, the carrier grade security, multi-tenancy, and when we talk about multi-tenancy, it's really that we have to have a number of NVF applications residing next to each other. They may have different security perspective, they have maybe different performance requirements, and they may also have different type of security requirements for the whole network. And that means that we need actually to provide a complete end-to-end multi-tenancy environment, including all the way from the applications to the VM and all the way out in the network. It needs to be complete isolated pipe from other network functions that are kind of sitting next to it. Software management and upgrade support, I think there is good things happening now, but we actually need hitless and automated upgrade on the environment. Backup and restore. This is really going back to a bit of the things that we have in ordinary in operators network that is more automatic backup and a lot of kind of inbuilt automatic recovery actions. Audit and troubleshooting, things like audit logging, a lot of monitoring capabilities, troubleshooting, because if these things breaks, actually a lot of the telecom services breaks. You can't make a phone call. And being a vendor to some of the major operators, when an operator can't make a telephone call, more or less they're contacting our CEO, so to say. This is really important stuff. The things needs to work all the time. You can't really have hours of breakdown. Because if you're looking on the standard requirements for a telecom network, we were often talking about 5 nines. And 5 nines means that the system can't be down for more than 5 minutes per year, including planning upgrades. There is no upgrade windows in telecom. You have to do all the upgrades and all the stuff. It has to be done within 5 minutes. This is pretty tough requirements. Assurance, that we need to have things that actually do in continuous performance monitoring beyond what we can do in Silometer today. So I think we're actually looking on the more, of course, this is the general requirements that we see, but we're also looking into what do we actually do, what type of contributing do we plan to do. And I think we also need, I mean, of course, we need the community's help, and I think it's very good now with Toby's keynote, et cetera, that we get the NFV requirements up on the table, we get the NFV market up on the table, and all the opportunities that arises within NFV. So I will not go into all the details here. But of course, there is a lot of things on the networking side. We need to add the capability to terminate and to stitch together the wide area network. We need to look on, how do we integrate with SDN controllers in a good way. A lot of things around quality of service. Nova could be things like dynamic logging to be able to turn on and turn off logging without stopping the services. We need to have a lot of more information coming up from the compute devices, so we actually know exactly how that device is configured and how many PCI buses it has connected or storage or whatever. We need really have this information. Cellular meter, things are like that we should really be able to do metering on a per tenant basis, have different metering capabilities for different tenants. Ironic, things like cleaning up the disks before kind of move, leaving over that hardware to another VM, because you don't want to have data that can be kind of left on the disk. You need to be able, for instance, to have APIs and functionality that cleans the disk before you hand over the VM or that hardware to another VM. And we talked about the framework and the high availability. I think this is so important that we have, because high availability is, it's not only about replication, of course, it's very much also about reliable software, but it's very much about the high availability. It's really built about the capabilities to monitor what is actually happening. I think I skipped this one. So when we looked on the carrier grade building blocks that we see, we start in the middle. I think we all see that this multi-vendor ecosystem is the key, because there will be a mixture of plugins, different type of hardware vendors, different type of guest OSs. It needs to be multi-vendor. And of course, I think it's also, I mean, over time, I think we also need to find a type of interoperability and this Linux Foundation stuff. But of course, interoperability is a challenge, but it needs to be multi-vendor. We need to plug in whatever the operator needs into this framework. Security and reliability, we're talking about that we need to retain that level of security and reliability that we have today. And of course, there is a bit of challenge with stateful applications. Resource optimization and resource utilization in an end-to-end network perspective, we will need to support both a distributed and centralized cloud deployment scenario. Unified and distributed resource pool. The operators have a large number of sites out. We need to be able to treat all these different sites and all the servers and the network equipment that stands in all these places as one pool of resources. So really being able to have the complete flexibility to move workloads across in the network. Because if you, for instance, have a simple server like a content distribution network, you should be able to actually move that function very close to where the load is, where it makes it optimal to place the CDN function within a network. And that is, of course, a balance between bandwidth and end user experience. So I think there is a lot of functions that actually can be balanced in a very distributed way. And that also goes for that with this unified and distributed resource pool, all the network functions, including all the load balancing, you know, all the security gateways, all the NATs, etc., needs to move along in this network. So you need to be able to orchestrate the whole set. Federation, we also believe some way, I mean, both within an operator and maybe between operator and other enterprises, you need to be able to share and federate the environment. You should be able, for instance, to put an enterprise workload close to the NVF applications. I think there is a lot of opportunities in the federation aspect of OpenStack. As mentioned about this high level SLAs that we have, but of course moving to more end-to-end based SLAs, we can't really only have the SLA on a per box, because the box will not exist any longer. We have a horizontal way of building the systems, and we need to move over to providing actually end-to-end SLAs on the service. But I can assure you that the service level requirements will still be 5 nines, because I think that is what you're used to making phone calls. We have to deliver on the promises for NFV about, the simplification, the speed, reduction in OPEX, and that is, of course, the rapid provisioning and more automated management. We are working on a number of proof of concept that we are trying now to figure out, trying to pinpoint some of the tricky areas which we need to understand more about. Live infrastructure upgrade that could be looking on host OS, seamless host OS upgrade, hot migration of VMs, including I think how we actually moving state logic. High availability, how do we actually make sure that we have a highly available cloud controller that can also be upgraded, talking about this cloud controller on the kind of 5 nines capability. alarm handling, how do you actually provide SNMP traps up from the execution environment up to the orchestration layer? How do you actually know that something has gone wrong? So this is also areas, centralized identity access management. Another view of the identity and access management is local access. If you have an earthquake, for instance, and you lose all your connectivity to that site, you need also to actually be able to have emergency access. Virtual switch, performance enhancement, and I think we are talking about really getting close to line rate. And I think right now, I think we have made a proof of concept where we are reaching 10 gigabit line rate on 240 bytes packet size without any dedicated hardware. It's only the accelerated vSwitch and the hypervisor. There is a lot of things that can be done. And reaching 10 gigabit line rate to a VM without actually having dedicated hardware on 240 bytes packet size, I think is good. I think there is more areas we need to evolve to really get this environment, the virtualized environment, as good as a native environment that we have today. So questions, I'll bring up Toby again on the table. Should I answer?
Why don't you go first?
I can start. I think it's a bit complex because I think we will actually need a couple of different SDN domains which needs to be able to talk to each other. So I think you actually need to have a transport domain that can both talk to OpenStack and talk to an NMS layer, for instance. So I don't think, at least in my view, it's not a simple answer. I think we will have a number of SDN domains, a transport domain, a data center domain, where you will have SDN controller in each one of them. And they need to be able to talk to an orchestration layer to glue it together. Because I don't think you can have one SDN controller that kind of spans the whole, because then it gets too complex. So.
And it definitely gets into an area where there's a small number of vendors that have very specific solutions for what you're describing today. But there's not a lot of broad visibility. Whereas, when we talk about higher end NFV functions, the spec is out there. There's a lot of development happening in that space. It's a little bit of a different dynamic. So I agree with Mats. It's really a different domain, and it needs a different type of group to focus on it.
Yeah. The question is to both of you. Can you hear me?
I don't. Yeah.
The question is to both of you, gentlemen. This is regards to vision. We have been seeing a lot of POCs and POCs and POCs. Have you really considered or do you visualize deployment in a year, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years? What kind of NFV deployments you are seeing in AT&T network, and what is your CTO office saying to the vendors?
Yeah, so the question was, there's been a lot of talk of proof of concepts within telcos, lots of proof of concepts for this or that. And then the real question is, are we ever going to really do it in live production? Which is a good question. There's two or three things that we have to deal with. I mean, part of it is more than just the technology, because we have proof of concepts that show we can do some of these things at the speeds and reliability that we need. The thing is making justification for it. And that's a lot of times tricky given the sunk investment in the existing hardware-based setups. So finding the right mix, and this is really one of the bigger problems we're dealing with today is, do we try to do a net new deployment, all separate and distinct, that's greenfield where unicorns live? Or do we do something in the brownfield where we're actually augmenting existing things or existing elements with virtualized elements and have them interwork? One area is easy to work on. The other requires a lot more integration and effort. And so the financial model is more head toward the brownfield model, and that's what you'll see us working on here in the next year. I mean, it's a year, 2 years out before you'll see some of these things happen for real at massive scale. We'll have point solutions for certain things in the mobility network here and there, but not at scale. On TV, it's a whole different subject. On the TV side, it's today. And if we don't do it today, then we have a problem. So
I can give the vendor perspective as well, because I think, as I said, we are planning to virtualize the majority of our core applications. I agree with Toby that I would say that big volume production deployments are, I mean, my view as well is like maybe 2 years away, so say where you see them in major volume. I think there is a lot of trials and tests all over the place trying the concept out. But I think there is some time before we have the full production environment in place as well.
Exactly.
Some of the core applications inside the 4G mobile network at AT&T, Verizon, and other networks are already using software-defined NFV functionality for diameter signaling routers and the home subscriber server and the policy control server. But many of those are very specialized and they have the availability built into the application. When you describe availability for NFV broadly, are you looking to put that availability into the application level, or are you looking to get it from the infrastructure so that it can be scaled across multiple applications?
I think it's both, actually, because if you're looking on telecom applications and if you're looking 3DPP standardization, you see that all applications more or less own their own data. It's very different compared to an IT installation where you have front and a back ends. I think we need to support how applications are built. Of course, I also think we also need, but with having the application and the state logic, if it's not really needed, it actually adds some complexity. So we need to really balance. So where should we actually have the state logic within the application? Where should we go for a more front and back end type of solution? But as I said, the starting point is actually that most of the NFV applications are actually stateful. I think that is the starting point.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, it's really at this point a mix. Things that, you know, ideally everything is, in my universe, is scale out and cattle. But that's a very idealistic way of thinking of it. Right now, there are elements that we have to provide support for in the infrastructure to maintain reliability and availability.
So Toby, you proposed a working group within Linux to help tackle NFV as well. There are other groups working to tackle some of the standards and strategies to get into that space. Why the Linux proposal, and what do you hope to get out of that direction?
Sure. So, the work that's part of the NFV open platform, the survey we're doing to see if there's interest in this area, is actually an extension of the work that's happening within the SEISG, the working group that has defined NFV, the NFV group. That group realized, in large measure because of OpenStack's success, that we needed something like OpenStack to achieve the goals at the NFV layer, the same goals. A multi-vendor ecosystem, you know, standard APIs that are meaningful, not open standards, but reference implementation standards kind of approach. So then the question was, okay, do we make a new foundation, or do we be part of OpenStack or ODL, or how do we do this? So that's really the question on the table. What do people think is the right approach? I believe that it doesn't make sense to create another foundation. Having gone through it once, it's a lot of work. Certainly, the Linux Foundation and its collaborative projects framework is very interesting in a way to bring new things to bear. And in some of the examples have worked very effectively. ODL especially has been a very effective approach that way, and that's why we started there. And the Linux Foundation is set up to do this type of surveying, make that kind of pitch to the marketplace. So.
And I think it's also a major change for the telecom operators, because we were used to writing the specification and then everyone, and we were agreeing, and then everyone went home for 2 years and came back with a product. So I think for us also, I mean, because I think if you're going to do something that is quicker than that type of standardization, you actually need to have a living reference implementation that kind of pushes it and drives the speed.
Exactly. And there's really the ETSI ISG, there's a very good center of gravity in that group around all of a good portion of the telcos globally and all of their vendors. That to me covers what you're saying about the specific buy-off. I think that is a good group to work with. So. Any other questions?
Or is time running out?
Yeah.
You mentioned the NFV functionality that actually enhances the network itself.
So your question is there NFV functionality that can actually enhance Neutron?
Yes.
What do you think about that one?
No, that enhance?
Neutron.
Well, I think we need to, as I said, this area about connecting the wide area together with the data center networking piece. I think there is a number of things we need to improve in the Neutron area. Then I think there is also, a lot of discussion. So say how much should we stick into the Neutron layer? How much should be above and how much should be below? And I think there will probably be a lot of discussions on the ongoing summits as well. So I think there is still, I think Neutron needs to probably be worked out a bit more.
But there are existing vendor solutions and telco solutions that actually, that are out there. We need to compel them to incorporate into the scheme. So I think that it's there. Just getting them to bring it into the open source world is going to be part of it. All right, so they're giving us the signal. Thank you, everybody.
Yep.
Appreciate the time.